We're going to consider then elements of the stars, as we've been discussing, and the planets, and also what that has to do with the Earth. And it's a daily news article that we see, isn't it, that it features heavily. There's always, even in central news, there's always some article regarding the discoveries or the proposed theories that the scientists in various universities around the world propose, because it captivates all of us. You know, it is a proportion of our lives that often we don't consider, and that half of our lives are actually covered by the stars at night time, and they are numerous in number. They are fascinating to see and to look at, and they hold marvellous scientific value to us, and also scriptural value to us. So we're going to be looking at perhaps exploring the cosmos, exploring the local cosmos at least for us, the local area around Earth, how that is interesting to Bible believers. Perhaps some advancements in tools, science and tools that we see and that we have heard of in the media, perhaps that often confuse us and don't give us the right impression of what the science behind it is about. And what the Bible has to say about astronomy, what the Bible has to say about those scientific things that we see and that sometimes give us a different impression of what's being understood. And of course, finally, God's plan, as we have read from Job, we've read the awesome power that God has and his purpose for his planet. So, as you are well aware, in the current news, the back end of last year, we managed to put pretty much a car-sized rover on Mars, which is what they call it there, Curiosity. And actually, there's not been too much said about that in the latest media hype. There was various months and weeks of discussion about what it found and the pictures that it took, and that all kind of is still going on. But again, it's quite an achievement that we've made it to one of our closest planets, which is a substantial step. And you can consistently see things like this, the incredible pictures that proves there is life on other planets. How they've done this is perhaps a mystery in terms of how they managed to get the evidence when they're so many light years away from us, and it would take many, many lives of man just to reach some of the places that they're talking about. But this is a typical headline that we see. And actually, there's a lot of focus these days on actually stepping back a bit and going back just to the moon to see if we can reach just our moon and see what we can find there. So these are the type of things that you would find in our media today. I was telling Abby and a few friends the other day actually that the latest news headline was that the US or the Americans were going to put some kind of a spaceship in between us and the moon just to protect the economy that would be developed over the next 100 years there. I mean, that's not scientific, but at least the type of thing you see in a film, that kind of headline that you would see. So let's just concentrate on our own cosmos, our local centre, in terms of the Milky Way, because just from our perspective, this is again going back, apologies, going back to a little bit of a GCSE or a little bit of a basics of our cosmos, of our area, of our Milky Way. But that's a picture from the furthest point we can go to at the moment of our cosmos looking back in, because it would take many light years, obviously, to get to the outside of the Milky Way and take a picture coming back in, and we haven't yet got there. And again, it's an artist impression from the top view, because we live in a flat the Milky Way is flat, basically, so that's from the top view with the spirals coming out there. So just a few facts there. The Milky Way is home to our Earth, as you might have heard. It's 25,000 light years from the middle. Again, hence why we haven't yet really managed to take a picture from the outside, looking inwards, a proper one anyway, because nothing from what we can send that could send it back would be in our lifetime, sufficient time. Again, so it's 125 light years across. It's estimated that there's 400 billion stars. I mean, even if we're starting to get into ridiculous numbers now, aren't we? When we see these images and we see these numbers, you know, we start to not disbelieve, but we start to try and quantify it in our minds. You know, when what we've read of there in Job about how he has made the constellations, how God has made the constellations and the stars, and he knows them, and he understands each one of them. It's just when we see these numbers, it's really difficult to comprehend, isn't it, in our minds? You know, the age of it there. Again, these are predictions and theories and estimations that scientists have come about through various means of whether mathematical or through observations of the stars. And it's believed that it's made up of other galaxies. It's made up of other areas that have been pushed together or formed together. And then it is believed, which I didn't realise, that they say that the predicted crash into Andromeda, which is the next galaxy to us, in about 8 billion years, if we're still here. Sorry, that's 5 billion years, if we're still here. So that's just some basic facts. And again, that's an artist impression of, as if we had a picture of us looking back into our galaxy, into Earth, that's what we would see, expectedly. Okay, and then there's some other interesting aspects that you can find on the web and in scientific books and journals and whatnot. And this is a mind-blowing experiment that they did. So they took a tiny extreme deep field look. So this square you can see there. I don't know if you can see it. Oh, it's that's terrible. It's okay. But there's actually to the bottom of the Earth there. There's a tiny little square about that big. To the moon, the size of the moon, it's probably about maybe 1 in 5,000. It's very, very small, and they basically just focused all of their all of the ability of the photography that they had of the Hubble telescope into that area, and they came across these things. So they combined 2,000 photographs that they had of the Hubble telescope. It had a small fraction of space, this tiny, tiny fraction of space in proportion to the moon, and they found, within that little section, over 5,000 galaxies. I mean, it is a phenomenal place to observe, is this, are the skies. And that's how much, I mean, again, if you can see that, it's 1/10 billionth the brightness of the eye to do that. So it's a very, very, very small amount of light that they had to generate to get that out, to get that image from the Hubble telescope. And that was done a few years ago. It's quite famous because of what they found. But the enormity, I think, of the discovery was astounding in terms of not only a scientific point of view, but perhaps what we were going to learn about God's perspective of how he has made all of those and has them in his mind. And then just for another scientific element to this, because I thought it better to just go through some of the things that you will encounter as you're looking at the cosmos and from a scientific point of view. This is called the Ionospheric Connection Explorer, which is pretty much this year, they're going to put it out this year. So they're focusing on the Earth, and they're focusing on the attributes that the Earth has to deal with in the environment that we're in. So just a reminder, we are the third planet from the Sun. That's the distance we are from the Sun. We have a very strong magnetic field, and that's because of our core. We have to have this field. If we didn't have this field, we wouldn't exist. It's as simple as that. And it's not just a core that is similar to all the other planets. It's unique to Earth, and it actually increases and decreases depending on the type of radiation that's actually encountering the Earth. You know, the level of the level of sensitivity to that field has been tuned exactly to meet our needs. The Earth has only one satellite planet, which is vastly important to our planet. We wouldn't exist, the way the seasons operate and the lakes and the waters operate wouldn't exist, and that's because of the moon that we have. Again, they learn this from the other planets and the bigger planets that are around us, Jupiter and Mars itself, and the other planets in the Milky Way. It is the biggest terrestrial planet. Again, a very important attribute of the Earth. And as you well know, as we are coming into spring, we have a specific position within the Sun's position. So they calculate it, although again, this is in dispute. They're tilted at 23.4 degrees in respect to the orbit around the Sun, making our seasons on its axis, on its respective axes. And it takes around 8 minutes for light to reach Earth from the Sun. And that's, I think I just use 8 minutes there as a bit of a, again, say from scriptural perspectives, because eight in scriptural terms sometimes can mean a newness, or seven being completeness. So it's interesting that they come up with that number. Again, that's just something that I've interested in. I was telling you that there is a magnetic field around the Earth, and this is the Ionospheric Connection Explorer, which they're doing this year. They're sending out certain experimental scientific instrumentation up to the top parts of space, and they're going to have a look at all the particles, all these radiation particles that come in. And you might pick up your phone and think, oh, I can't have GPS or I've got no signal, and you're blaming your provider, when in actual fact it's this magnetic field that's causing the problem. It's knocking out the satellites, it's knocking out a lot of the, it's interfering with that connection. And so they really want to try and understand this. But when you read about this, they call it the ICON mission, you actually end up realising that there's some really interesting stuff that they're coming out with that are actually defying a lot of the physics that we as mankind have established over hundreds of years. So they can get particles that can accelerate as they come into this field and go from zero to light speed and then go back again. And it's a phenomenon that they don't know. So they're trying to understand, A, why it does it, and B, what it impacts us and our modern technology. So again, I just want to reiterate some of the basic facts of our planet and how unique those facts are to us. And the fact that if they didn't exist, just a small portion of us, even in our position from the Earth, didn't exist, we wouldn't be here. We wouldn't be here at all. And they are so intrinsic to us, and they're so important to our planet, that they have they are understood to be foundations for our existence. Well, what does the Bible have to say then? What does the Bible have to say about this? Well, one of the most famous parts of the Bible that we know of, if you go over to Genesis chapter 1, in creation, we get this comment, don't we? So Genesis chapter 1, again, many of us in the room know this, and we read it. It's not a throwaway comment by any means, but it's a comment, and it's an account that carries such a weight with it from what we've just been shown here. So in 1 chapter 16, we read that, don't we? God made two lights, great lights, the greater light to govern the day and the lesser light to govern the night. He made the stars also. And I've just shown you some examples of how far humanity has gone to look it from a scientific perspective at how many stars there are available in our cosmos, let alone beyond it. And there are hundreds and hundreds of billions. So for scripture to make a comment like that, it shows the level of power that is put into this word. Okay? It carries on. It talks about the multiple stars in the heaven. And if we go over to Deuteronomy 4, where we're introduced to the promises that are given there, we read in those promises one of the first instances where they're told to look up to heaven and to look at the stars, to look at what's there, because this is something that they can see perpetually, as Job said. Although we know stars are nothing but an echo or a light that are fading away, they're being shown something that it will last their lifetime and a generation to come, and yet they're still there. God set them there for a memorial and for a promise that as they are sustaining themselves, even today, that the promise will be that his promises will remain in a similar fashion to us. They will never fade but increase, the difference being. In verse 19 we read, "And when you look up to the sky and see the sun and the moon and the stars, all the heavenly array," this reading from the NIV, sorry, "do not be enticed into bowing down to them and worshipping the things the Lord your God has apportioned to all the nations under heaven. But as for you, the Lord took you and brought you out of the iron smelting furnace, out of Egypt, to be the people of his inheritance, as you are now." So he's saying, although you can see the stars in the heavens, there is a promise that he holds, and there is no need to give any kind of notice or worship to the stars in terms of them being something greater than yourself, being a deity in that sense. And Job, which we have read, who we believe is older than that, older than what's been written here, actually had that understanding. He understood the different elements of the stars. We read in Job of the different constellations that were there before him. And he names them, doesn't he? He names them Orion and Pleiades. And he understands the magnitude of which they were made by, the power that required to make them. And yet we read there in Job 25 verse 5 that the stars are not pure in his eyes, in God's eyes. And that's very true, because we know that stars are but light that fade eventually. They are a shadow of a light that's dead and only coming to our planet now. If we go over to Psalm 147, again, it's an echo and a confirmation from all of the writers that we find in Scripture that there is an understanding that God had everything to play in making the stars and the planets and everything around that we see today. So 147 and verse 4, "He determines the number of the stars and calls them each by name." I mean, just that sentence there is astonishing, that if he calls each of the stars, whether they're planets or the stars themselves, by name, is, you know, it is an astounding an ability. "Great is our Lord and mighty in power. His understanding has no limit." Well, you would have to expect that you would have no limit if he has that ability to name each star. "The Lord sustains the humble but casts the wicked to the ground." And he's asked for thanksgiving and to sing unto that power. And not to feel that the understanding of what we see in the cosmos, what we see in the sky, can overwhelm us with the intensity of the power that's there. Okay? And it decides to move. There you go. There's just some pointers that I put there. So, again, just the scale of which this comment applies to in terms of the number of stars that he's labelled, and how he's left it as a memorial for those that were previously saying you would have promises that would come to pass, and that he set some of those promises and used the skies to ordain them, to show them. Again, we have some other points we have here. So also we understand, or we know, that Scripture uses the heavens both as a symbolism, both in symbol and as a physical means. We know obviously the birth of Christ, there was a star that the wise men followed. And that was a physical request. I mean, if we just consider that requirement, you would have to have a star that either would be set by God instantly in the skies, or the star that had died at a certain time. Maybe it was a star that had come through at a certain time, or it was one of these events that we see through our skies. But still, the timing of it was a phenomenon itself. But here we find and we read that we are told. Let's go over to Matthew 24, in fact, and we'll see one of the accounts there that are given about the end days, or the time at the end. Again, a lot of them are given as a symbol and not perhaps as a physical action or a physical event. So we read here, these are the signs of the end of the age that are given to us. If we read there in Matthew 24 and verse 29, again the whole chapter goes through the different events that would happen before the return of Christ. So immediately after the distress of in those days, the nations, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from the sky, and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. So there's some aspect to that, perhaps, with the sun being darkened and the moon not give its light, that would happen, that we know can happen. We have eclipses, we have the ability to restrict the light that happened in Christ's death. But here, the stars will fall from the sky and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. I put it to you, it's more likely that it's resembling the nations, or those that are ruling or those that are in charge of the nations at the time, that are no longer able to sustain the nations, and so they fall, as does the nation at the time, and the Lord Jesus Christ returns. And we read, at that time, the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and all the nations of the earth will mourn. They will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory. Quite possible, considering the enormity of the power that we've seen from just making of the stars and the naming of the stars. So prophecy in itself, just like this, is a whole subject on its own. So I urge you to ask questions, to read it, and to consider it. Some of it's confusing, some of it's quite straightforward in terms of the actions and the events that will take place. But if you go over to Revelation 1, and they all complement each other, a lot of these other prophecies do, that's their design. So if we go over to Revelation chapter 1 and verse 20, we're just going to show you an example of perhaps how a symbol is used in here. So we read in verse 19, we'll just start there, of chapter 1 of Revelation, "Write therefore what you have seen, what is now and what will take place later. The mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand, and of the seven golden lampstands in this hand. The seven stars are the angels of the seven ecclesias, or the church. So the seven lampstands are the seven churches." So again, it explains specifically that the stars in this instance are actually churches, and we then are told about the different types of churches going through Revelation until it gets to the other symbolism. Unlike what we read in Matthew, whereby he was given a portion of what was likely to be true, and then a portion of what was likely to be more of symbolism in terms of what was to happen. But if we go over to 1 Corinthians 15, we can actually read that the stars are used as a slightly different means in terms of representing those that are looking forward to being part of the kingdom. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 41 that we've read there, we read there, let's go into in verse 35, "But someone may ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body will they come? How foolish! What you sow does not come to life unless it dies. When you sow, you do not plant the body that will be, but just a seed, perhaps of wheat or of something else." He's saying there's something physical that would respond when you have to reborn, when you have to give something life again. You have to start from the seed again, can't you, and grow up again. But it says in verse 38, "But God gives it a body as he has determined, and to each kind of seed he gives its own body." So God has the ability to regenerate these things. "All flesh is not the same. Men have one kind of flesh, animals have another, birds have another, fish have another. There are also heavenly bodies, and there are earthly bodies." And this is the change, perhaps, this is the change that he's talking about here. "But the splendour of the heavenly bodies is one kind, and the splendour of the earthly bodies is another." It's subtly different. "The sun has one kind of splendour, and the moon another, and the stars another, and the star differs from one in splendour. So will it be with the resurrection of the dead. The body that is sown is perishable. Ourselves, we know we are mortal. You know, we suffer the mortality of our flesh and we die. It's a known fact. We return to the dust from where we come from. But there's a promise here, isn't there? The body that is sown imperishable, it raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonour, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown in a natural body, it is raised in a spiritual body. And that's the promise that we look for in the return of the Lord Jesus Christ, that we will be resurrected and will be found worthy enough to take on not only that spiritual body, but that life of everlasting in the kingdom that's on offer for us. So I'm going to just put a few pointers there of how in Scripture, as I've shown you, you will come across some aspects that are true in terms of the physical attribute of the world, how God plans to use the sun and the moon and the stars as physical signs to us. And then there are some whereby the sun and the stars and the moon are used as signs to us of the nations or the people or how God's plan is working from that point of view. Okay. So I just put a few biblical accounts here. So these are physical biblical accounts to us, which are hugely significant. So we go to Joshua 10 verse 13, the sun stood still and the moon stayed. So if the sun stood still, that would mean to us, from a scientific point of view, that the earth would have stopped. If the earth stopped, then I guess the gravitational pull would change and we would either all fall off or everything would go out of kilter and then we would spin off into some outer space. But yet, we are told here that this phenomenon happened and there was a fight that happened in Joshua's time and the sun stood still for that time, for that period of time. Okay, we read also that there was a king and he wanted his life to extend. And so they said, God said, okay, well, if you look at the clock, if you look at the shadow clock, the peace clock on the base, and if the hour clock turns back 10 degrees, then you'll have 10 extra years, and such so happened. But for the world to turn back on itself, again, a similar thing would happen. But yet, we are told it did. That's the kind of power we're dealing with here. So we have seen, again, the sun was darkened. So the sun was darkened, we could probably understand in terms of an eclipse. That's quite an easy one to comprehend. But the other three are just a phenomenon that we've never encountered in our lifetimes. And certainly from a scientific point of view today, it's an astounding feat that someone is able to hold the earth, or God is able to hold the earth and stop the light from going around it any further, or to generate a new light to replace it at the time. And we're actually told by this too. At the end of Revelation, we're told this: the night will be no more. So when the Lord Jesus Christ returns, and when eventually the Lord God joins the earth too, that he will replace the sun. There'll be a replacement, or the whole light, the glory of God, which is an immense light, will cover the whole earth. And we're told there, aren't we, that the lamp for our sun, the Lord will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever. They're the closing words, some of the closing words of Revelation 22. That the whole earth will be no longer in shadow. It will no longer have to dwell in darkness. I think that's probably a better symbolism of the earth, but it will be filled with the glory of God. So, just like to thank you for listening. Here are some summaries that I've made. Just a couple of notes there, that space that I found is not designed for our habitation. God never designed space for our habitation. It is a very, very hostile environment. You get swings, temperature swings of minus so many hundreds to so many thousand in heat. The radiation is not for us. And you can just see how much the earth has been designed to protect us. Not necessarily to keep us in, but just to show us how much of the design has been there so that we can survive and we have the ability to survive. And finally, I've got there, the workings of our solar system is controlled and used by God to show his plan and purpose. And just one bit of one story I'd like to leave you with before I finish. I remember being at university and I asked one of the professors there why it was that the earth was rotating at the speed it was, because we were talking about satellites and how they orbit the earth. And he just turned around and he says, we can't answer that scientifically, but we know that if it was too fast or too slow, we would either fall off or we would spin out into the space. And he could only say that that was by design. There was no, and this is a chap that had been studying, you know, the science of satellites for a long, long time. And he said, if the Earth didn't do what it did, we would never have the ability to copy. And that's effectively what they've done, and that's how they've learnt from the design of the Earth. And he wasn't a believer in God, but he was certainly a believer that there was a design in the Earth and in the structure that we live in. Thank you.